Hello and welcome to Fast Charge, episode 99. We are so close, so nearly there. I am your host, Dom, back as ever, joined this week by the stalwart two. We've got Toddy over there and Lewis on the controls. And this week we also have Chris joining us to help cover some of the Xiaomi Redmi launch stuff we're going to be going through in a minute. Chris, as we've been noticing in our little warm-up chat, Chris's beard is growing longer by the day. I don't know how long it's been since he last trimmed it, but there is a point where he's going to be more beard than man, and I think we're getting there.
I need to get it off the bottom of the screen, right?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
ZZ Top levels, please.
Also, if it's 99, do we not all get ice creams with a flake in them?
Oh, that would have been great. Been
good. Yeah.
So that'd be episode 120, because that's how much they like cost. Oh, now, basically. Yeah.
We can keep doing Freddo episodes and keep chasing the price of a Freddo forever. Yeah, no, seriously, though, it is episode 100 next week, which feels pretty mad. So I don't know. We'll have to do something to mark the occasion. So if anyone listening or watching has any thoughts on what kind of nonsense they want us to do for episode 100, please shout and let us know, because I would love to outsource my labor to you and save myself from coming up with good ideas for next week.
Do a countdown of the best 100 phones ever.
Oh god, no. Takes all day.
Yeah.
Right, anyway, this week 99, we'll deal with that first, worry about 100 next. We are going to be talking through a few things. First up, the kind of big launch of actual new devices of the week. There was arguably a big launch this week. We'll get to that. The big launch of new devices this week was the Xiaomi Redmi Note 11 series, which got a global unveiling. They had kind of been unveiled in China already, but actually the global phones are not the same as the Chinese phones. So these are slightly new, different handsets because, I don't know, Xiaomi gonna Xiaomi. So we're going to run through them. Next, we're going to go through a couple of reviews. So first up, I have the Samsung Galaxy S21 FE, which I'm now ready to talk through, having been using it as my main phone for a week. And following that, Lewis is going to turn in his thoughts on the Moto G200, which we chatted about on the pod before. If you can't remember that one, that's a Motorola with pretty much flagship specs, really, really impressive flagship specs, but for like $400, kind of £400, $500. So it's very, very affordable for what it has, which caught my attention. Before that, let's run through some other little bits and pieces. So the big news this week maybe was the confirmation of what we kind of already knew, but the Galaxy S22 series is coming. It's around the corner and it is launching on February 9th. That is now official. Samsung has said February 9th for the next Galaxy Unpacked and basically confirmed it's going to be the S22. It also looks really likely now that the Tab S8 is coming at the same time. We thought it might be. But if you're in the US right now, you can kind of reserve a handset. You can reserve an S22, which you're not actually putting any money down yet. You're kind of reserving the chance to pre-order. And they give you the chance to do that for the next Galaxy smartphone, but also the next Galaxy tablet. So it feels pretty much like as close to confirmation as we're going to get that we're going to see the Tab S8 range on February 9th as well. So that is all coming up. If you want to know more about what to expect, particularly from the S22, we actually covered all of that last week. So if you weren't watching, listening last week, go back and check that out, because the state of the rumors hasn't really changed a lot in the last week, and everything we said 7 days ago pretty much still stands. Secondly, the other big bit of news this week was from Huawei, who held their official global launch of the P50, finally. Technically, they didn't actually launch the P50, but they launched the P50 Pro and the P50 Pocket, which is the foldable version, the little sort of clamshell Z Flip rival foldable. We are not going to talk about these in depth today, because other than getting European pricing, we didn't really get any new information about these. Plus, I'm hoping we're going to be able to review both of them soon enough. So fingers crossed, one episode in the next few weeks, we're actually going to be able to go through and give them a proper review. So keep your eyes out for that. We'll have more to say on them soon with a bit of luck. But we didn't really want to dwell on talking too long about phones that you already know everything about. The only real news is European pricing, which is expensive for both.
Yeah, very.
Not surprisingly expensive, but it's expensive. They're both over the 1,000 euro line. Neither of these are cheap phones, which obviously has its ups and downs with Huawei, but this is no big surprise. What else? Google also has a big launch on the way. We don't have anything official from them, but we've had kind of a flurry of new rumors this week on the Pixel 6a, which is going to be the mid-range offering, the Pixel Watch, which has been rumored forever, it feels like.
Yeah.
And also the Pixel Fold, their kind of Oppo Find N slash Z Fold style foldable. That is now tipped to be called the Pixel Notepad, a name I do not like. It feels very clunky to me, and very kind of, I don't know, just boring, like a notepad.
It just seems old school. Like,
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It's like, it's their first tech product, and they're like, oh, we need to bridge the gap between the traditional and the new, so let's call it the notepad. But no, everyone understands.
If you're big putches, you can use it to take notes. Like, oh, cool.
Yeah.
But it could be worse. The name comes from a 9to5 Google report. And to be fair, they say this is kind of like a brand name Google is working on. It's not final, so this may not be what it's called. But they also know that the other name that had been in contention internally was the Pixel Logbook.
Is this like the engineers were left in charge of the whole marketing?
Yeah, that's all I can think. Like, this must be like early engineering stuff, and at some point it reaches the marketing department and all of this will get thrown out.
No, we're not doing that.
But then let's,
to be fair though, like the last kind of tablet they did was called the Pixel C, which is not, I mean, it's better. It's not a particularly strong name though, so maybe they're just not good at naming tablets.
How can you have access to so much data and not get your branding right? Like, you've got more data than almost any company in the world. Use it to come up with a good name, at the very least.
Anyway, so maybe the Pixel Notepad. Same report says that the good bit of news here is apparently they are targeting a $1,400 price tag for that, which is $400 cheaper than the Z Fold 3, which would be kind of the closest direct rival in the US market. So if that's true, that seems really, really promising. But we'll see. Anyway, all three of these feel like they're going to be coming in May, because we've had the Pixel 6a tipped for May and the Pixel Watch tipped more specifically for 26th May, which is around the time Google normally holds its I/O conference. We previously thought that the foldable was coming in spring. So with all these kind of aligning, it really looks like maybe we're getting a Google I/O at the end of May and probably a keynote on the 26th for now, where they are going to unveil the watch, the 6A, and their foldable phone. Obviously, this all might change, but this is kind of where it looks right now, which is exciting. OnePlus also seems to have a flurry of devices on the way. And I feel like I'm repeating myself, because I'm pretty sure I had this exact same thing in the news segment last week, which was a fresh slate of new OnePlus handsets that were tipped to be on the way, like the Nord CE2 was one of them. But we've got even more now. In addition to the two or three I mentioned last week, this week we've heard about the OnePlus Nord 2T, which is not the Nord CE2 or the Nord 2 CE, it's different. Also a OnePlus 10R, which would be an India-exclusive version of the 10, even though there hasn't been a 10. And that maybe, we've also heard, they might be working on their first Ultra phone to come later this year. So I guess that would be a OnePlus 10 Ultra, if this is true. I don't know. And, you know, no one knows what that one would involve. For some of the others, there are spec leaks and specific chipsets. You can have a look. But yeah, a OnePlus seems to be planning to... That's already win out another like 5 or 6 handsets we're expecting this year. So after kind of slowing down, they feel like they're picking up again. But B, any sense anyone had of a structure to their naming, to their release schedules, to how the product lines tie together is out the window at this point, surely.
It always used to be like clockwork.
Yeah. Like
you could pretty much predict the date of each, you know, event, basically. And now it's just like the what?
And it's just it just makes it easier, doesn't it? Oh, go on.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
Now it seems explicitly engineered to just make me lose my mind with all these like weird model SKUs and stuff that have no kind of rhyme or reason to their trajectory.
It just makes it harder to understand the range overall, doesn't it? You don't know what came before, exactly. What comes after. You don't know if one's better than the other. And maybe they want that because they don't want you to know what's the best one. They're just like,
consumers, look at these.
Have this one. Look at this. All this amazing. Yeah. But I don't know.
I think part of it is they're moving towards, you know, we've seen more and more different OnePlus phones come out in different markets. You know, the US has a very different set of OnePlus phones available to Europe, which has a different set to India, which has a different set to China. And I think they seem to like this approach and they're doing more and more of that. But it's just so confusing, certainly for journalists, but for fans as well, looking at it from a global perspective and trying to keep track of all these things, because, you know, how are you meant to keep track as a global fan of like the fact that there's the Nord 2T, but also the Nord CE2, and also the 10R? and there's not even a 10, and there was a 9RT that only released like last week, 3 days after the 10 Pro came out. So, you know, as a global fan, it's a nonsense. And any, you know, that tech community that brought them up, I guess, can't keep track. The big question is, does that matter to their bottom line? Because the average person buying these phones has no idea what they're selling in other countries anyway. And so it
Alex
might be fine.
In the comments, Alex says, he says he's just hearing letters and numbers now at this point. And I feel like we're all kind of feeling that as well. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, I had that feeling beginning when we started to see kind of the string of Nord models within a year. And you got the Nord and the Nord 2 and the Nord CE. And then, but also the N200, N100, N10. And it was always unclear how these are all meant to relate to one another. And I just feel like that's getting worse. But yeah. Anyway, last bit of news for today is, you know, a little fun story about a little OEM that's pulling itself up by its bootstraps. But Microsoft has finally put Android 11 on the original Surface Duo. Wow. As other brands are rolling out Android 12 across their filled device portfolios, Microsoft, which currently has two Android devices on the market, has just managed to get the previous version of Android onto its first phone.
I mean, is it on two phones technically that they've stapled together? Like, it's kind of two phones.
It's kind of. So they've got four devices if you want to count it by screen. It's a bit of a shambles. I remember a tweet, and I'm afraid I cannot remember who tweeted it, but it was a tech journalist or influencer or someone. But sort of in commenting on this stuff the other day, said that they remember being very excited about Microsoft entering the Android OEM market, and how strange it is to think that now, just like a year or two later, there's a reasonable claim that they are the worst Android OEM on the market. It's astonishing. Again, despite only two devices, and they're cool. I haven't used either of the Duos. I really want to get the chance to try one out for a bit. We just ran a review by Niren of the Duo 2 on the site, which I think was, you know, similar to what he thought the first one, which is, you know, good but not good enough. Got a lot of flaws. And they're clearly getting there, but man, it's Microsoft. It, like Lewis, you were saying about Google, you know, if any company has the resource to do this better,
exactly,
Google, but also Microsoft. Yeah. They have all the money in the world.
And they're too busy making HoloLens 7 or whatever.
So for a handful of people who own an original Surface Duo, you can now update it to Android 11, if you so please. Hope to God that fixes a lot of the software problems.
You mean the handful of people that still have a review sample?
So I posted a photo on Twitter, I think, end of last year, because I saw someone on my train was using a Duo and I couldn't believe it. And then everyone in the comments on the tweet was like, definitely just a Microsoft employee. Like, yeah, that's the only way 100%. That person is rocking a Duo. Yeah, probably.
All right, let's move on. So our first big topic of today is the Xiaomi Redmi Note 11 launch. Xiaomi has unveiled four phones in this series to go along with the phones that previously unveiled in China. These have some of the same names as the phones in China, but not all of the same specs. So we're going to kind of shelve the Chinese model for now and just focus on these global ones for ease. But we have the Redmi Note 11, the Redmi Note 11 S, the Redmi Note 11 Pro 4G, and the Redmi Note 11 Pro 5G.
You got it.
It's a bit of a mess. I'm going to sort of smush two of them together from the outset to make things easier, which is to say the two Pro models, the 4G and the 5G, are, as far as I can tell, exactly the same except for the chipset, in that one of them has a MediaTek, the other one has a Qualcomm, and the MediaTek one is a 4G chip. And the Qualcomm one is a 5G chip, but those two phones are, I believe, identical in every other spec and design element and everything. So think of the Pros as the same phone, you just, it is a choice of 4G and 5G. And then incorrect. It begins to feel a bit easier. God damn it, already?
Yeah.
What else is different?
So for some bizarre reason, the 4G version, which doesn't actually have 4G on the end, it's just called the 11 Pro, that has a fourth rear camera. Let me just double check. That has a 2 megapixel depth sensor, which the 5G doesn't have.
We needed the space for the extra G.
Yeah, literally. You either get an extra G or you get a depth sensor. There's no in between.
Yeah, I mean that's a tough choice. Not.
That's.
There may, even, There may be other things, but that's what I mainly noticed was that it has four rear cameras.
The 5G has the same camera module, but it has that thing where one of the lenses is actually just a black circle that says AI in the middle.
Oh, God. That's a Realme thing. That's
I hate the fact, yeah, I hate that that's becoming more common now. I'm just like, not please, okay. No. Yeah.
I mean, it clearly is here just to cost everything of being like, well, we've got this camera module with four cameras in. It's easier to put the same one in, but you almost wonder if a 2-megapixel depth sensor isn't cheaper than making a black circle that says AI in the middle.
Especially if you're buying them in bulk.
Exactly. Yeah. All and right, also, so I'm already getting this wrong. So
on the 11S and the 4G model of the Pro, is that right, Chris?
Oh, say that again.
The same chip, same MediaTek chip on the 11S and the Pro, but not the 5G one.
It's a Helio G96.
Yeah.
I feel like that's been around for ages as well. Okay, cool.
I think you're thinking of the G95.
95 has been around for a long, long time.
And
but it kept getting used to like
ish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Helio G95 is on the Moto G31 that I just reviewed today.
That's what I mean. It's still getting used. Like it's I feel like I've been writing about that chip forever.
Can I just say if on the chance that Alex is still watching in the comments, I apologize now, because if you thought the numbers were bad before, then this is about to get really intense.
So much worse.
But yeah.
So that confusion aside, these are pretty nice looking phones for the price. I think that's the kind of classic Xiaomi thing. They range from, I think the cheapest end is sort of $180 for the regular Note 11, and it goes up to about just under $400 for the top spec Pro 5G. So they're still in that really good, affordable range. I think, you know, all of these are either budget or cheap mid-range, the kind of way most people look at them. But I think all of them have AMOLED displays, right?
Yeah, that's basically the crux of it, is that, they're all AMOLED, either 90 or 120 hertz. And then you've either got 50 megapixel or 108 megapixel cameras, depending on which model mm-hmm. you're going for. And you've either got 33 or 67 watt charging, pretty much 5,000 milliamp hour across the range, adapters included. The cheapest 11 is $179, and that's for 64 gigabytes. And then the most expensive Pro 5G is 379, and that's 8/128.
Nice. So, I mean, Redmi's
solid,
like,
budget or mid-range. Yeah.
Yeah, Redmi's numbered Note phones, to try and be specific, they usually sell incredibly well, and they usually end up on our best budget and best mid-range charts because of the value for money that they offer. These all seem like really solid shouts. Usually they're in contention with what Pocophone, which is effectively Xiaomi still. So it'll be interesting to see what the Poco brand does that is built on the same kind of underpinnings, because usually they share so much as well behind the scenes.
We'll also get we have the Realme 9 series coming soon, which is probably going to be the obvious competitor. In fact, the Realme 9i has already been announced in India. Yeah. We're just waiting for the other Realme 9 phones, and they've already started teasing them, but there's sort of already the space in which you start seeing where these phones are going to pull apart, because Realme's already been a bit bullish in announcing they're now doing a 9 Pro Plus as well as a 9 Pro. They've said both their Pro and their Pro Plus are going to be 5G, and the Pro Plus is going to run a MediaTek Dimensity 920, I think, which is, if I've got my chipsets right, more powerful than any of the ones in any of these. So Realme already seems to be lining itself up as kind of, they're maybe going to deliver better CPU performance than the Redmi Note 11 series, but Redmi's maybe going to, you know, some of these camera specs are impressive. The fact they've all got AMOLED displays is really nice, and I'm not sure we're going to see that across the whole Realme range. So,
yeah, especially at the lower end, Realme's numbered phones, usually you have to choose between like super high refresh rate or AMOLED versus LCD. That seems to be that's where their trade-off usually ends up.
Yeah, so, and that's why I really like the fact that all of these are AMOLED, because I do think it is the trade-off that there's been at that bit of the market for a while, and the fact that they've just made the choice to make all of these AMOLED with different refresh rates, I think simplifies that for consumers a little bit. And you're not trying to explain to someone why the higher spec phone has a lower refresh rate and things like that. It's just much cleaner. They're all AMOLED, which means they're all going to look pretty nice, and you're just paying extra for the full 120 if that's something that, you know, that you're into.
Yeah, the regular 11 looks particularly interesting. Because I'm not sure, like the mid-range, the 11 Pro 5G, I think, has got more competition. But the under $200/pound mark, there's not a huge amount under that.
That's price cap.
That's actually really good. Yeah. Like there's the Xiaomi Redmi 10, which is 90 hertz, but it's got really slow charging, and you know a few other bits and pieces that are meh. And the Moto G31 that I just reviewed has actually dropped down to 60 hertz. It was 90 on the G30, and it's got some other okay stuff. But it's like, yeah, these are okay. But this is sort of like, oh, it's actually ticking pretty much all the boxes that you could hope for at that price.
One of the other oddities across these phones is, I think all of them, I might be wrong, but I think they all have IP53 ratings, which I'm not even sure, you know, it's always this funny thing with phones, especially the cheaper mid-range ones. I don't know that necessarily means this has better water resistance than other phones around the same price, but it does mean it's certified to have that certain level of water resistance. And it is, if nothing else, interesting that Xiaomi has paid for it. Yeah, and they've added $5 to the price of every phone by going and paying for that. Because that was always what OnePlus said when they didn't offer IP ratings, because they always said, it is waterproof. We just don't want to, you know, it costs money to get a rating. We don't want to pass that on to the consumer. And then they kind of gave in and started doing it. But they still need to really do it for the flagships. But yeah, it's interesting here for them to make a point of getting these certifications. But it is a peace of mind thing for a lot of people, I think, just knowing it does have that rating. I mean, it's IP53, not IP68. So it's splash resistance, not, you know, dunk it in the bath resistance. But yeah.
But for comparison, the Moto G31, again, that's just water repellent coating, which is what most of the budget motos have. They don't have IP.
I just think it's just that extra level of reassurance, right? And I think it's a funny thing because you can kind of get it into your head that the people spending a lot on a phone are going to care more about these protective features because it's so much more valuable.
Yeah.
But probably often it's the people buying a cheap phone who care more because they're maybe less in a position to buy another one if it breaks. Whereas someone who feels that they can throw a grand at their phone maybe is a bit more likely to feel they can throw another grand at it in a year when they smash it or drop it in the bath. But the sort, you know, someone who's only spending a couple hundred on their phone, you know, they might want to make sure that phone's going to last them a while. So I think it's really nice to see this kind of stuff filtering through a bit more to the low end of the market. And I do want to applaud that.
Has anyone here used a Redmi phone or a Xiaomi phone recently? Have like a drop off at the end of last year in terms of releases. And then this is like the start of their new year release. But just thinking about what they're up against with regards to user experience, because that's, I think, really then the main crunch point. The value is so good, but more often than not, that's where we mark those phones down, I think, is the user experience is either too messy or convoluted, or there's too much bloat or something or other. And I know that they've refined it, but also we've seen Oppo refine their version. We've seen Realme refine theirs. I'd be so curious to see what emotion UI is it? 13? MIUI, excuse me, 13?
These all ship with 13, which there's not a huge amount. There's a new sidebar which you can swipe in from the side, and you get a vertical list of all your favorite apps, which you can choose which ones are in it. But they gave me a whole bunch of like optimization stats that supposedly going to make everything run a lot better. Something called liquid storage, which they likened to defragging on a PC, is up to 60% faster. God. Yeah.
Okay.
RAM optimization is up to 40% better. And then battery life up to 10% better.
7 or 70?
Up to 10% on the battery.
Oh, okay.
That's 70. 70 would be astonishing.
Yeah. It's like, whoa, what was going wrong before? Jeez.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to say. None of us have used MIUI 13 yet. And I think the thing is that the changes I would want to see to MIUI are the kind of things that they are probably going to keep making but not talk about when they do make them, which is just rearranging settings menus and trimming things and tidying things and making things a little more intuitive. And it's not sexy OS updates that you hype about, not least because for the most part, it is more things where it's saying, oh, this was crap before and we've improved it, which you don't really want to say. So, you know, yeah, previous MIUI jumps, I've always felt each one is a bit better than the one before, but it's not because they've got exciting new features they've dropped in. It's just because I go in and I'm like, oh, there's a couple fewer like pre-installed Xiaomi apps on this phone. That's nice. And yeah, it doesn't take me as long to dive through the settings menu and find the thing I'm looking for because they've put it in some arse backwards category that makes no sense.
Yeah, stay tuned for Dom's like op-ed on the 10 sexiest UI features of the last 12 months.
That's next week. The 100 best Android skins.
There we go.
Nailed going it. Down to like specific version numbers.
Yeah, I guess it's harder to sell, advertise like the appeal of it if it's all behind the scenes stuff. But I would much rather, yeah, better optimizations and less clutter than a new sidebar, Xiaomi, just FYI going forward.
But yeah, as you say, that's the thing we knock them for a lot of the time, especially when you're in that point where the spectrum is identical, price spectrum is identical, and you're saying, do you pick between the Xiaomi and the Oppo or the Realme? And I think we do tend to lean, if the specs are about the same, we'd all prefer using a Realme phone over a Xiaomi phone. But yeah.
I think the last thing to point out is possibly on the design, which we haven't really talked about too much, because they've gone flat-sided like the iPhones of recent times.
And Vivo. And Oppo as well, actually, with the Reno range that launched in China recently. They've all taken on this slab-sided approach again. I guess like
bravery.
Apple did it, so they're like, it's okay now. Yeah, bravery, yeah, exactly.
We can all go back to flat-sided phones again. Hooray.
Yeah, I don't hate it.
Yeah.
I will say, you know, having been using the Vivo V23, I think I spoke about this briefly last week, talking about the Pro model, but because most Android phones are narrower than most iPhones, as a hand feel thing, I think they actually work better for the straight sides than the iPhones do. Whereas I find the iPhones a bit uncomfortable with those straight edges because of how wide the phones are. That's not to defend the kind of stylistic choice of these brands, because yeah, I mean, it's obviously just a shameless, Apple's done it. We want to put out phones that kind of look like iPhones. And that is obviously the thinking that's going on here. But yeah, I will say, if you hesitate about it because you're worried about the comfort, because that was obviously a knock that a lot of the iPhones got when they made that switch, I actually think it perversely suits Android phones better, broadly speaking. But I still prefer curved edges.
Yeah, I think so far it's only Chinese phone makers who've done it as well. I was just trying to think. I was like, have Motorola done one? I know they are technically Chinese now, but yeah.
And I think so, and Samsung hasn't. I think Samsung probably won't.
No, I can't imagine they would.
Cool. Anyway, yeah, so they are Redmi Note 11 series is, out now in the sense that it's been announced. I think with these things, it tends to be a pretty gray area for each country and market as to when they're actually on sale. And although there are four phones, they are not all going on sale everywhere. In the UK, where we're based, the regular Note 11 and the Note 11 Pro 5G are coming out, but the S and the kind of 4G Pro are not. So yeah, you know, if you're actually interested, have a look which one's out where you are. But yeah, that is the range. They are, I think, a pretty solid start in the 2022 budget phone wars. I think this kind of sets the bar fairly high, at least on a pure spec basis. So Realme and all the other Xiaomi subsidiaries have their work cut out for them in matching these. So I'm curious to see what they come up with. Yeah. All right, let's talk, having name dropped Samsung a second ago, let's talk S21 FE, which is we moaned about OnePlus's release cycle, but we've spoken as well, Samsung also got this all wrong. And this is kind of the crux of how you have to talk about this phone, is it was first tipped to launch maybe last August. Then everyone thought it was going to be October. Then everyone thought it was canceled. And then it ended up launching just this month, earlier in January at CES. It ended up launching 11 and a half months after the S21, I think. Or maybe it was 10 and a half. Either way, around 11 months, almost a full year after the rest of the S21 range launched. And as we now know, almost exactly 1 month before the S22s are arriving. Yeah. And everyone kind of knew that at the time this one got announced as well. And you can tell, obviously, Samsung wanted to give it a bit of breathing room before they announced the S22 launch. But I think most people who were aware of the FE would also be kind of aware the S22 was looming. And yeah, I'm in this funny position with this phone where I broadly really like it. I think it's a lovely piece of hardware in a sort of upper mid-range, lower flagship kind of space. I think it looks really nice. The specs are really impressive. The camera's been really solid. But I don't think you should buy it because it should have come out 6 months ago and it probably should have been cheaper than it is. And if they'd at least managed one of those two things, it would have been a good buy. If they'd managed both of them, it would have been an amazing buy. As it is, I don't think anyone should buy it.
I mean, it's we are now getting this kind of like influx of products that either never materialized or were delayed like this. Like we're going to probably have the same conversation when we talk more about the P50 range.
Yep.
When that like comes to when we've done our reviews and stuff. Also just touching on the last point there, we're talking about how Samsung probably won't adopt the straight sides, but then I really held that up and it reminded me, I did see it briefly the other week. It's the closest to a straight-sided Samsung I think we've seen in a while.
Because it is a flat display and the edge is a bit curved. It's not actually rigidly straight like an iPhone is. But it is kind of, and there's a little bit of curvature on the back.
There's a definite like split between the two materials, finishes, angles.
Yeah. And in terms of material, it's Gorilla Glass Victus on the front, which is pretty solid for what it is. Aluminium frame and plastic / polycarbonate back, basically the same build as what you got on the base S21. So pretty much the same build quality as a regular S21. No glass back, but neither did that phone. Design language is what we're roughly expecting to see with the S22. So it's very similar to the S21, except that the camera matches the rest of the body. I really like it. I do, you know, if I had one big thing to say to give this in favor of the regular S21, I prefer the look of it. I think it looks nicer than the kind of contrasting colors they did before and those very chromey reflective camera modules they did last year. I didn't love that. But so I do think this looks better. But again, this is weird caveat where you're like, but all the leaks tell us this is what the S22 is going to look like in 2 weeks as well. So, you know, if it's the design that swung you, you could also wait a couple of weeks.
If it had landed roughly around, say, between August and October last year, do you feel like it's a worthwhile upgrade on the S20 recipe or upgrade? You know what I mean? Like a revision, I should say, of the S21 recipe. If it landed at the same price as it has landed now, but say what,
I think
6 months earlier?
Yeah, the same, launching six-ish months ago at the same price it is now, it would still have walked into the baited trap that is the Pixel 6 price, because this is $100 more than the Pixel 6 in the States, and that is a relatively hard sell for this over the Pixel 6, and that would have been the problem no matter what. In terms of its relation to the S21 range, yeah, I think it's solid. The funny thing is they haven't, you try and start comparing it to the S21, and they haven't changed all that much. It's got basically the same display. It's a Snapdragon 888, so it's basically the same chipset. In fact, it's the same as that. It's Snapdragon 888 in some markets, Exynos 2100 in others, though it's more Snapdragons than the S21 range had. So if you are, you might have a bit better chances finding a Snapdragon model because Europe gets a Snapdragon for this, which I know a lot of people care about.
Where gets the Exynos? You
know, Australia. Korea? Has it.
Random.
I think I heard that India does, but I'm not certain. So there are a few places with Exynos models, but more Snapdragon, mostly Snapdragon. The camera's different. That's the main drop you're getting. Display quality is the same, but it's in that sweet spot where it sits in between the S21 and the 21 Plus. So the S21 is a 6.2-inch display. The Plus model was a 6.7-inch display. And this is a 6.4-inch display. So it is a bit in that Goldilocks space where if you thought the S21 was a bit too small, but the Plus model felt like a big phone, this, it feels like a normal size. And it doesn't feel like either like a small phone or a big phone by modern Android standards. So I think a lot of people will find this hits a sweet point on the size. You still get an IP68 rating. You still get wireless charging. You still get it's a 4,500 milliamp hour battery, which again, I think sits just in between those two S21 models in terms of size. So even more so than with than with the last FE phone, on the specs, this really feels on a par with the rest of that range. It's just the camera, basically, where it's dropped a little bit. It's still a pretty good camera, but it is, you know, not quite the same tier of camera performance. So yeah, I think 6 months ago, this could have looked like a really solid offering for the price it was, where you basically say it's £100, $100 price drop from an S21 for people who don't care as much about the camera but like the rest of it.
I have a sneaking suspicion this is going to be a phone that does well in carrier retailer shops and places like that, where people aren't as driven by what's under the hood, and they just go, oh, this is the new S21 phone,
exactly,
and it's got new colors, and it's probably going to get paired with a smartwatch or some headphones or something or other. And it's upgraded or revised over the S21 that came out a year ago, so it's better. Like, that's how it will get pitched.
And that's exactly it. If you can successfully pitch to someone that it's as good as or better than the S21, then sure, you're going to win people over. Anyone who kind of is in the know that it's not really necessarily as good is going to start looking and probably realize that, hey, the S21 is cheaper than this now. Because it is. You know, I checked on Amazon right now. In the UK, I could buy a regular S21 for £30 less than an S21 FE. So, and this is partly the problem they had before with the FE, where it came out a little too far from the original S20, but it's just exacerbated this year. And the S21 is a cheaper phone now. So this is worse than the S21, but costs more. There is one caveat to that, which is maybe noteworthy, which is because of the delay, this ships with Android 12. But it has the same 3OS version update.
That's
promise.
Cool.
So this, the FE will get Android 15, but the 21 will in theory cap at 14.
That's quite cool, actually.
So that is the one reason you might point to someone and say, hey, actually the FE makes more sense. So even at the same price, you're getting a slightly worse camera, but you're getting one more year of software support.
Yeah.
And for a lot of people, that is a sensible trade-off. So that's kind of the one person I'd say, if you want these and you really are thinking longevity, you want this phone to last you another 3 or 4 years, this is going to last a year longer than an S21, at least from a software support perspective.
A couple of practical questions, I guess. Does the 6.4 inch, is it still one, can you still use that phone one-handed with the 6.4 inch screen, or is it just on the...
I think this is the size you can use one-handed comfortably.
You can still get,
This is, you know, you get much bigger than this and it wouldn't work so well. But yeah, I think a 6.4 inch display on an Android these days, you know, it's still pretty slim bezels and stuff like that. It's still a relatively thin device. So I personally find it comfortable enough one-handed, but I don't know, maybe I've got big hands.
And the other thing, I think, which Lewis just had a picture up of the colors that it comes in, which I think we touched on briefly when they said they're actually launching the phone. But I still don't think, I'd like the muted tones they've gone for, generally speaking, especially the purple, which I think you have, Dom.
Yeah,
is that right?
This is the lavender.
So hard to see. On
the camera. I thought you had the white one this whole time.
Yeah, exactly. When I saw it in person, it looks really nice. It's like a really nice powder lavender.
It's a very nice color. Yeah.
I feel like they should have done what the base numbered iPhone does and have all the colors. And I feel like they just needed more colors. But I guess that was maybe part of the whole delays and whatnot.
I think there is also a navy blue one that's a carrier exclusive in the States,
right?
They did, because the S20 FE launched in
six or eight
colors.
It was a lot, and
it was a big part of the hook and the pitch they had for that phone at the time. So either that didn't work and they found that a couple of the colors just didn't sell, maybe, we don't know. Or, my best guess is it's purely just a question of the practicalities of chip shortages and everything, getting everything out. And if you're going to find a way to ease the pressure on your manufacturing pipeline, I think cutting down on a couple of colorways has got to be one of the easiest ways to do that. I mean, we saw Google do that with the Pixel 5a, right? If I'm getting everything right, where that one just came out in black.
Yeah.
And there'd been talk that they had more colors planned, but they were just like, no, we're just doing a black one now. Because, hey, that streamlines the whole operation. It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, even the, was it Chris, you had the 4AXL? Didn't that only come in black as well? It was just the 5 that had the two colors, like black and green, and that was it. They were pretty conservative.
I think you're right.
Oh, man. Sad. I'm all for crazy colors. I mean, again, you'll talk about it when we get to the P50 Pocket in a week or however long away, but the... finishes on that are a little bit more interesting.
They're pretty wild. But no, I do like the design of this. I like this color a lot, this purple, even if it doesn't show up well on camera right now. I really like the feel. I like the fact that this is going to be even harder to see, but the camera module does just blend into the body.
really like that.
They don't look discreet. It looks like it's a single piece of plastic.
Yeah.
Which, again, I just like the look of it. It works for me much better than the standard S21 aesthetic. So that would be another reason to grab this one over a base S21, I guess, is if you, like me, think that this one actually looks a bit nicer and you're going to get that extra year of software support. So, you know, for all of my, you shouldn't buy this phone. I think there are compelling reasons why someone might, at least measuring it up against an S21. It's not a complete non-starter, but yeah, it's tough. And in the US, this is $100 more than the Pixel 6. And again, the things you're going to be looking at are basically, maybe you prefer the look of this to the Pixel 6. I certainly do, though other people disagree. This one has a telephoto lens, so it's got more versatility than a Pixel 6 camera, but the main lens on the Pixel 6 is definitely better than this one. So there's pros and cons, but you know, I'd be weighing it up with pros and cons if they were the same price. When the Pixel 6 is 100 cheaper, it's just, no, buy that one. It's the better phone.
It probably won't be long before it is the same price or potentially even less. Like, give it literally a month or maybe 2 months.
I know.
And I can almost guarantee Samsung will knock $100, $150 off that phone.
It's what's so tricky when you end up, you know, it's hard in a way reviewing a phone when a lot of what your verdict kind of comes down to is the price, because you always feel like, well, I'm reviewing the price at launch, but especially for Samsung, and well, Samsung aren't the worst, but for you know, non-Apple brands, prices will drop. They will drop relatively fast.
Yeah.
And they will change. Like I said, we're now 11, 12 months after its launch, and the S21 has dropped by about £150 in the UK. And that's, you know, right now, that's not in a big sales season. That's just the general price it's selling for on Amazon at the moment. So yeah, this will change. But that does then just add to my sense that Samsung shot itself in the foot here, and that once it knew it was putting the phone out 6 months late, it should have taken at least $50 off the price tag. And if it had done, this would look a lot more sensible and be a lot closer to a good purchase and a sensible purchase for most people. And it'd be a much easier recommendation if it was 50 or 100 cheaper. At 100 cheaper, I'd really be like, yeah, this is great. It's, you know, you can probably still get more bang for your buck from other brands, but it's a compelling offering at that price.
Yeah.
At $700, £700, it's sort of, well, it's not bad. But
we've tasted that Pixel camera, now we know how good it is.
Exactly. Google really, you know, Google went aggressive on its pricing, and they did very well in that. Even one of the other things I was looking at, you know, other phone prices that are better than this. This is a bit cheaper than an iPhone 13, but it's more expensive than an iPhone 13 mini. I know there's a different screen size and that, you know, attracts a different audience in that sense, but still, you can get one of the current iPhone range at full price for less than this, which is meant to be Samsung's reduced price model. And again, you just start looking at that and being like, something's gone wrong here.
It makes no sense.
You know, the way this market pricing has landed just doesn't add up right.
Yeah, if the meter stick is Apple and your affordable option is within their price range, then you've messed up somewhere.
Exactly. It's all gone a bit wrong. And I think that's part of the problem, is it's also unclear, is the FE meant to be the affordable option? Because again, I run through the spec list and everything's the same as the S21, basically, except the camera. You know, that's really the main area they've changed stuff. So it doesn't feel like they're going for affordable option. But the fact that they do offer it at a reduced price makes you think it is, and the messaging just gets very weird as to who this is for. You know, even more once you throw in the fact that the FE stands for fan edition. And the last thing you can think of is, for the fans, we made the camera worse. Like, oh, yeah, that's the fans what the fans were clamoring for.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Well, I do want to know whether the telephoto on the FE is better or worse than the telephoto on the regular S21. That would be interesting to see side by side, because there's more actual optical zoom.
Yeah, I'd like to do some proper side by side comparisons, or at least dig up our S21 camera samples and try my best to compare them. I haven't been able to do that yet. I mean, I will say the camera here is good. It's not flawless, and it's not as good as in general as the main S21 stuff, but it's a pretty solid setup, and the telephoto does feel decent. Even the night mode stuff, I've been pretty happy with the results I got from it in night mode stuff and things like that. And there's OIS on the main camera and on the telephoto. You also get a higher resolution selfie camera than the S21s. I haven't, again, compared directly to see if it's a better selfie camera.
Is it? But it 32? Is higher resolution.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because the S21 Ultra had a 40 meg that binned down to 10 meg images. So this seems like if it does the same tricks, then
think this is a 32 fine. That bins to 8.
Yeah, that's hopefully fine if it does the same kind of stuff as the S21 Ultra.
So it is a different selfie camera to the S21, but whether that is a better selfie camera, I wouldn't want to make that promise. But yeah, so I'm still mixed about this phone. I haven't finalized my written review, which is going to be going up on the site really soon, because I'm honestly partly keep umming and ahhing about how to score it and how to put it in that place, because so much of its problems just feel like, well, it's just 6 months late, and 6 months ago I would give this half a star more than I'm inclined to now, and things like that, and the pricing feels a bit funny. But as Chris said, if you wait 2 months, that price will change, and more so than ever, because the price is always going to change. But hey, the S22 is about to come out, so guess what's going to happen to the price of every phone with S21 in the name. But then again, that's a double-edged sword, because guess what's going to happen to the price of the regular S21? It's going to go down. It's probably going to go down faster than the price of this phone.
Yeah. Then it's really so, just screen size, I guess, is what you're deliberating over.
If you think that 6.4-inch display is like, that's the sweet spot for you, that's the size you want, cool, buy this one. Yeah. But at that point, it's almost like, well, why doesn't this just launch with the other ones as a, you know, S21, S21 mid and S21 plus and have them like that?
But then they have done this before with the Note Lite, Note 10 Lite, I think it was, came out like 7 months on from its predecessor.
Along right with an start, S10 Lite at the same time.
And the S10 Lite, that was even a better example, yeah. That was a 2020 phone for a 2019 range, and it was very confusing.
Well, it was the same thing. I mean, the FEs are what the Lites were. They just changed branding, and clearly whereas Lite didn't work as well as confusing FE brand that no one really understands.
So but I used to hate light branding. It was so I didn't know what it meant, really, because it was like the budget version, but it wasn't quite budget. And
when it's attached to a flagship line, it makes no sense. Yeah, it's the super expensive flagship phone, cheap edition. Like, but a light version. Was it cheap? No. Is it a flagship? No. So.
And then when Apple brought back SE, then we had other companies also using SE and light.
Yeah.
For different like product lines, but they were basically the same spec. It was
This is where Google does it better, with just literally having the A on the end.
And yes, which is meaningless, but it gets meaning by being used enough, and now we all know A. It just means the cheaper version.
Yeah, cool. A doesn't stand for anything, but we all know it's the mid-range budget version.
Obviously, Samsung has the problem where it also has its A series, which is in theory its cheaper range of phones, but it runs up to the A72, and we're expecting an A73, but they're priced pretty close to where an S21 FE sits, so
they
really
seem overpriced to me at launch.
Yeah, it muddies the waters. But yeah, this is the same space that I feel like Samsung is all too often in when it starts trying to do mid-range devices, which is it just cannot compete with the Chinese OEMs and get that spec to price balance correct, and it always prices too high. And I'm disappointed, I guess, because the S20 FE still had that problem a bit, but did feel like a corrective step. It felt like they were actively trying to compete with OnePlus and Xiaomi and had figured it out, and they hadn't gone far enough, but they're taking a step in the right direction. And this feels like a step back in terms of the way they've priced it and positioned it.
Yeah. Which feels is like a bit waste of resources.
Yeah.
Yeah. And funny notes on this, and I know this is an old, thing with Samsung, so it's not super unusual, but on charging, this has wireless charging, which is great, but the wired charging is 25 watts. The cheapest of those Redmi Note 11 phones is 33 watt charging.
Yeah.
Like the worst of those, that one that's less than $200 has faster charging than this does.
And I think in China, the Pro Plus model, which we were not getting anywhere else, has 120 watts as well in that range.
Yeah.
So,
right. Samsung has its own reasons for being very cautious on charging speeds, which we all know too well. But yeah, it still is the sort of thing that begins to stick in the teeth a bit. You feel a bit like, how high-end is this really in funny sorts of ways? Which is a good segue to turn to our final review, the Moto G200, because this is a phone that in a way is the polar opposite in that they have taken an extraordinarily aggressive spec list and crammed it down into a really affordable price tag.
Yeah.
And if you were to put the S21 FE and the Moto G200 side by side on paper, I'm pretty sure the G200 beats it spec for spec almost, while coming in at a little over half the price. So
it's pretty impressive.
That's the problem we have with the Samsung. So Lewis, why don't you run us through a bit more on what we're getting here?
Yeah, so like you say, it's kind of, it's the most premium mid-range phone I've seen for a while. if that makes any sense. Because you've got like the headline spec is it's got the Snapdragon 888 Plus, which is fairly, you know, it's not the latest anymore, but up until about a month ago it was. So, you know, that you're still getting really top tier performance.
Still the latest you can buy in a phone in the West, I think.
Yeah, that
we don't have any 8-in-1 phones in the West yet.
No, I keep updating our rumors and leaks on the Motorola X30 or Motorola 30 Pro, as it's supposedly going to be called, which is meant to be this phone, but we still don't have it yet. Indra will get it first, but no one's got it yet. So, yeah.
Well, in that case, top spec.
This
top
is
spec
the most
processor.
Powerful chipset on the market in the West for at least another week or two.
So, yeah, no, so that's obviously the headline, but it's not just about the the Snapdragon, so it's paired with 8 gigabytes of RAM and 128 gig of storage standard, but you can't expand that this time. They did take away the SD card slot, which is a bit of a disappointment. But I mean, it's something that a lot of people are doing these days, I suppose. I've really seen SD cards in many phones.
I mean, especially the move to the cloud.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it becomes less and less important.
How many people
yeah.
want physical expandable storage these days? I know some people do, but
I think as long as you've got enough. Concern. As long as you've got enough base storage there, then you don't really need to worry. And I think 128 gig for most people, that's enough. You know, I'm not filling that up anytime soon.
Photos,
yeah, literally.
Fine.
Yeah. So yeah, no on that front.
Subscribe anyway. So
yeah, exactly.
But I think the main thing for me is that it's a big phone. Like this is a big. So this is a 6.8 inch display on the front. That's 0.1 inches bigger than last year's one.
That's just about like ultra phone size.
Yeah, it really is.
So
yeah, it's
getting close to the S21 Ultra, Mi 11 Ultra.
It's a 20. Yeah. It's a 20:9 aspect ratio. So yeah, it's a very tall one. But I think it's basically. I notice it's not that much thinner, than the 13 Pro Max, and it's taller than the 13 Pro Max. Let me get that up on the camera.
What's the fit and finish like? Because that looks pretty premium as well. Like, is that plastic back or glass back?
So yeah, it is a plastic back.
Finish.
It catches the light so well. Like, it doesn't. I can't really get it here because it's just my indoor lights here. But when I was out taking photos of it, like it shimmers in the light so nicely, and especially around the camera at the top here. It's just got a really nice effect to it. It's a little bit of a fingerprint magnet, but there's not much you can do. And yeah, people do complain about the plastic, but. Once you get over that initial, you know, it's not cold in the hand, essentially, it doesn't make much of a difference overall. If anything, it's a little bit more durable than what you get from a competing glass back. I'd feel a little bit more comfortable letting this drop than I would an iPhone or something like that.
It does also tend to make phones a bit lighter, and especially for a phone that size, that's got to be worth something.
Yeah,
that's a
good point. Yeah, it's not exactly. It's definitely, compared to kind of the gaming phones that have that similar size display and all that extra added heft, this is definitely a lot lighter than, and especially even the iPhone. I think it's about 202 grams, so it's not lightweight, but for a phone of that size.
That's about 20 grams lighter than the Mi 11 Ultra or something like that. I'm with you that I think plastic backs are sometimes unfairly maligned.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't been talking about that, you know, with the S21 FE, it's never bothered me that it's got a plastic back.
No, exactly.
I don't see the issue there. I understand for a lot of people it feels like a step
back.
They
can be nice, and it more depends on the what sort of finish they put on it. Like
the texture.
That matte
finish
of the FE looks really nice.
This one's got a nice little matte to it as well. It's not quite, it's got that matte surface, but then reflective underneath. So you kind of got this weird best of both worlds thing with this. I mean, I really like the finish. I think the design of this is one of its strong points. I think it's a really nice phone. It looks great. And I love the camera bump. I think I was saying this in the pre-show chat, but it's kind of, it's weird. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get this up on the camera because of my NVIDIA broadcast being a bit glitchy, but it kind of, it's like a tapered camera bump
wedge.
It's like a tapered
wedge shape.
It kind of just disappears into it, so there's no like kind of noticeable end like you'd get with some of the others. I didn't notice it when I first got it because obviously it comes with a case, so yeah, just completely missed that. But when I popped the case off, I was like, oh, this is a nice little extra added touch. So before we go on to the cameras and stuff, I just want to say a couple more things about this big old chonky display, because it's not just a 6.8 inch 20:9 aspect ratio display. It also has 144 hertz refresh rate, which is solidly in gamer phone territory. It's up from the 120 hertz from last year. It's either 90 or 120 last year, so it's quite a jump.
I think it was 90 on the G100.
Yeah, I think I'm leaning towards a 90, I think. But yeah. So yeah, that's a an impressive jump upwards.
It's definitely one of those phones that's in that space, like you said, in a gamer phone spec space, which we're seeing a little bit more of now, which is phones that are consciously going for that extra high refresh rate, top spec chip, but not all the RGB LEDs and angular designs and that kind of thing. And it's cool. That stuff's still out there, but this looks more like a normal phone. But equally, if you are actually if you do play a lot of mobile games and want something pretty high end for that, this does tick that box. It definitely feels like that's who they're going for. I think if you're the average phone buyer who doesn't play games, this is probably not the phone for you because the spec list is so balanced in one direction. It doesn't make a lot of sense for things, because the big compromise there is it's an LCD rather than an AMOLED.
I was about to say, that is the one complaint, is that it's LCD. I don't mind that too much, but I think that's maybe this. I'm just conditioned over so many years of using iPhones with LCDs, only moving to OLED in the last couple of years. I'm just like, LCD is fine. There's no problem with LCD. No, I mean, obviously the colors aren't quite as vibrant and the blacks aren't quite as deep, but in general use, I don't think that's going to matter to most people, especially people that are buying a £400 phone and not something that costs the grand £1,200.
Well, like the gamer talk, like it's come around again. I think you reviewed the G100, and I think at the time you said that was sort of a covert affordable gaming phone. It looks like they've repeated their recipe.
I think it's awkward because they've got the Ready 4 thing, so I think they also want it to be powerful enough to power their Ready 4 desktop thing. And that was the big push with the G100, is that they wanted this to be a desktop experience as well as a mobile one, so I think that's why they crammed it in the first time. But this time around, they don't put because first time they bundled the Ready 4 dock in the box to be like, come on, you can use this on a computer, you know, it's okay. This time they're like, okay, people don't really care about that, let's just try and save a little bit of money here. So it is cheaper this time around. It's £50 cheaper than it was in the UK last year.
Does it still support the Ready 4 stuff?
If you want it, it does support it. you can get yourself a third party dock. I mean, to be honest, you can get yourself a USB-C to HDMI cable, and it basically does the same thing. It's still there if you want to use it. I've tested it in the past. It's okay. It's about as good as, you know, Dex or any of the others are. It's a niche perspective, but if you've got a use for it, it's there.
I mean, the number of times Motorola specifically has tried to get a desktop experience out of their mobile devices is like, I've lost count now. Like, I think they're more than any other company. They've been pushing it for years.
They're so determined for it.
Yeah, they're
so
determined.
I guess it's partly, you know, I mean, if they're owned by Lenovo, so they're part of that whole setup. And I do wonder if there's that space that comes probably partly from Lenovo and maybe partly from Motorola's own history and brand place, that they could be a phone that companies buy en masse for employees.
Yes.
You know, like Motorola is a pretty safe brand device to be like, to sell as enterprise devices, exactly. Mm. And for an IT guy to go and buy 1,000 of them. And, you know, having this kind of feature makes sense for that. And Motorola just feels trusted enough. Lenovo has experience shipping enterprise products and stuff like that in a way that maybe you wouldn't, not every Android brand feels positioned to fill that kind of niche. And Motorola are, I have no idea what the uptake there is if people do buy them as enterprise devices, but they certainly feel like they're in a position where if that market exists, they could capitalize on it more than most.
For sure.
One of my main questions is to do with why it's a Moto G, because obviously historically the Moto G range has always been, you know, budget. You know, we had the G1, the G2, G3, G4, and we still have Moto G's that are budget, and but there's also the Edge 20 range, which that feels like the mid-range Motorola's. So then this one, like, I didn't really know much about this or the G100, but I was surprised to find, you know,
they're so
found
premium. Yeah, I mean,
but the G100 wasn't Edge before.
Yeah, I was like,
China,
I would direct
right?
you to China's Moto Edge S from last year, or whenever it was, because that was the G100.
Was the G200 an Edge in China? I can't remember.
I don't think so. I didn't see anything about it. I think it's just the same as every other Motorola branding. It's just Motorola's terrible at branding. There's no rhyme or reason to it. They just picked a number and a letter out of the hat, and they were like, yeah, that'll do. And that's genuinely why I just can't understand Motorola's branding, like the process behind it. So I genuinely think that's what they do these days.
It should be, you know, it used to be very clear with the E, G, X, Z, you know, going up in that order. And so just like, this could be an X easily.
Oh, easily, yeah.
I mean, I think the the affordable G phones, the budgety ones, they sold so well that Motorola then just wanted to use the G branding.
Yeah, I suppose you're
to
right.
To just
yeah.
make just sales, even if it doesn't people, really people work.
They're like, oh, I've heard of the G, but what's the E? I've never heard of the E.
People know yeah. of Moto yeah. G, so yeah, yeah.
So I should probably point out as well, there is a little bit of weirdness going on with that Snapdragon 888 Plus, because during my benchmarks, it benchmarked at the same or slightly less than Snapdragon 888 powered phones like the Mi 11 and the Samsung Galaxy S21, like a good couple of hundred points less. And it's not just my sample, because I looked on a few other reviews and they were all commenting similar things. So I'm just like,
how was thermals? Was it hot?
Yeah.
It didn't feel hot in the hand. Like, it felt absolutely fine. Like, this is why I couldn't understand. I couldn't. There was no notable throttling that I could see during the benchmarking. Right. But it just benchmarked slightly less.
I had the same with this, and it ran a bit below the average for an 888, but it got hot. Not hot, but it got warm during benchmark. It's heat management.
Yeah, I mean,
the 888s were pretty bad for heat management, and I'm sure the 888 Plus is worse.
Yeah. But it's just, I notice it. When I was doing it, I kind of left a bit of time between them because I thought it might have been a thermal problem. I kind of left it a bit of time before I reran the test again. But yeah, similar kind of numbers. And I was just like, oh.
It could mean they're throttling to prevent a thermal problem rather than there is a thermal problem, which is throttling.
That would make sense.
I mean, it's
actually.
The funny thing. They have the experience in making the Lenovo Legion devices, which, you know, you will use all these high-end bits. And I'm sure there is a Legion with the 888 Plus in it. It's the one downside of buying one of these gaming phones that has gaming phone specs but not gaming phone design is probably they don't bother to put in the gaming phone cooling systems.
Yeah,
I know. Which does this slightly limit how much you're going to get that max out of the chip.
With the ZTE Axon 30 Ultra last year, I realized after reviewing it that I ran some extra benchmarks, and in those, it was like the high-end benchmarks, and it turned itself off after 20 minutes. Because it got so hot that it was just like, I'm not doing this. Like, the whole phone shut down until it cooled down. And I was like, wow, that's how bad the thermals can get on some of these phones. You know, it's not all about the top-level specs. But I mean, with that being said, the performance is still top-notch. You know, you're getting 144Hz refresh rate. That translates to a nice, silky, smooth experience as you're scrolling through. There's no jittering or lag that I noticed. It can still run for the gamers. It can run Call of Duty Mobile and stuff like that with max textures enabled. Ooh. So I really haven't got a complaint about the performance and stuff like that. It was just an interesting little bit of data that I thought I'd throw
in. Yeah, it's a full HD display resolution.
Full HD plus. Right? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I did just check as well. I mentioned in China the Motorola Edge X30, which has the HM1. They also launched at the same time the S30, which is basically this phone for China. So that's what this year's version of that
right,
is.
Oh, right, okay.
Yep. So, yeah, which I have written about. I just there would be something. Didn't put the pieces together. It's the same design, everything. So.
Hashtag Sony phones.
Always.
So let's talk a little bit about the cameras, because it's got, as you can see, there's three of them on the back. Not all usable, surprise, surprise. So you've got the main camera is really good, 108 megapixel, fairly high res. Then it's backed up by an ultra wide that is actually a little bit worse than last year's model. So that was there was a 16 megapixel, it's dropped down to an 8.
That's quite a jump.
Yeah, it's halving that res.
That takes kind of pixel binning off the table, really.
Yeah, there's no pixel binning here. There is for the main mode, but not for the ultra wide. And then that is backed up by what a surprise, a 2 megapixel depth sensor. Our absolute favorite. Yeah. the main 108 megapixel is where it's at. Most of the time I didn't spend a lot of time using the ultra wide. I mean, the ultra wide's fine, but there is more noticeable distortion around the edges than what I'd like. I think a lot of other manufacturers spent the last few years kind of fixing that with software, if not the hardware, you know, and kind of straightening up those edges a little bit at the side so it's not quite as fisheye as it once were. But there is still a bit of that effect with the G200. But yeah, the main 108 megapixel uses 9-in-1 pixel binning tech, so it reduces it right down, obviously bumping up the light and stuff like that. And with that enabled, I was pleasantly surprised by the quality of the pictures, especially for the price of the phone. You know, £400, I'm not expecting anything too amazing. Obviously, that's in kind of outdoor conditions, you know, the ideal conditions for taking photos. They do look great, and that it does fall off a little bit once you come inside, but that's not too much of a surprise, I don't think.
I was going to ask, how is it in like night mode and low light and stuff like that. You kind of answered that a little bit already, because I asked because the spec list I'm looking at, it doesn't look like there's any OIS,
no,
which is going to be the big limit in low light.
So you do get, there is light available when the light levels go down. It is okay at it, but without the OIS and like a decent night mode, it's not, it's far from the best at dark photography at night. There is 8K video though for those that want it, but
that's pretty cool.
Who wants it?
Just nobody wants thing to say you can do though. That's cool.
Exactly, you've got 8K, there's no stabilization on it whatsoever, so it will be shaky as hell. But it's there if you want it. I recommend going at 4K at 60, so much nicer.
If I could do an 8K video time lapse, that'd be cool.
That'd be pretty
like
cool.
From a tripod or something.
Yeah, that would make things a little bit easier. But
It's a funny phone though, because the specs are so high in some areas that it throws me off trying to judge it. So in my head there, and noticing that it didn't have OIS, I was a bit like, oh, that's rubbish. And then you remember, it's a £400 phone.
Yeah.
I wouldn't normally knock a £400 phone for not having OIS, but I expect to knock a Snapdragon 888 Plus phone with 144Hz refresh rate. That phone seems like a phone that should have OIS, because that phone should be an £800 phone, So it is such a funny one. It's obviously so specific in where it's strong refresh rate and kind of core processor and decent sized battery and that kind of thing. And then it's fine in camera, but a bit weaker. And, the display is built for gaming, but it's not AMOLED, so it's maybe not the best screen for watching Netflix on or photography or that kind of thing. But for what it wants to do, it definitely sounds like it's doing it very well. And at a price that I'm still pretty blown away. Motorola never used to release phones at this, with that kind of spec to price relationship.
It's so competitive, and we also have to consider that unlike a lot of the rivals, it's near stock Android as well. Like it is clean.
And usually Motorola's editions are like welcome editions.
I love the Moto mods, not Moto mods, whatever they're called, the Moto shortcut,
the Moto
things.
Actions and things.
That's it, the actions. Like chop to turn on the flashlight, so and stuff good. Like that, and twist to turn the camera, and all those fun things. I out of all the kind of skins and stuff, I do like the little additions from Motorola's, and they have added a little bit extra, so you can customize the theme a little bit more this time. But I mean, not for me, but it's there if you want to have a go at that. The only downside to the software is that they've promised one update.
That was going to be my question.
Mm-hmm. And it's starting on 11, right?
Starting on 11, so it's getting 12.
Take you to 12.
Yeah.
So they got in hot water for the S20 series, and it looks like the same is true for the G200. What a shame.
Yeah, that is disappointing, because I think that is the one thing that is holding it back. I'm not too sure about the security updates. I've got to imagine it's a little bit longer than a year for that.
But it is definitely the security update thing feels like a point of pressure that is hitting the big American manufacturer, or rather the brands that sell in America, and it's becoming a big point. Google and Samsung are both making big points about this, and we're seeing Motorola, to be fair, does sell well in America and they're not included, but for whatever reason it doesn't feel like most of the Chinese OEMs are feeling a lot of pressure on the Android update front. They're just, a lot of them are not really engaging with it too much. They're still happy to be like, we're gonna do one. They don't.
But I think
it's clearly not something that they feel is impacting their sales in a meaningful way yet.
I guess their strategy is price their phones cheaper, so people are more likely to just buy the next phone.
Yeah, it's a bit more disposable tech, which is not good.
Makes me uncomfortable.
Overall, I think it's a great phone. I think for the price, it's really competitive. If you're a gamer, 10 out of 10. If you like watching Netflix, maybe not so much, but I'm a big fan of the G200.
As someone who just read Lewis's review and I haven't used it, I had this kind of, we have I look after our chart on the site for the best mid-range phones, and Lewis told me, I think, this should go in. And I'll admit, I kind of inwardly scoffed a little bit. And I was like, a Motorola phone, like maybe it'll squeeze in another 10. I'll have a look. All right, I think I put it in a number 4 because I read through the review and I was just like, it's got that refresh rate and that chipset and that storage for £400. Okay, wow, this is a really good phone. This is, actually taking out a lot of the competition in terms of the ranking. So, I am very impressed without having used it, but it sounds pretty great to me.
Yes, yeah.
Cool. Well, that'll do us for this week. We will be back next week for episode 100. I do not know. We're going to have to do something. Who knows what? But there will be, you know, some sort of commemorative mark. Maybe we'll just get mugs made.
Drinking games.
Maybe to celebrate episode 100, we'll all just sod off and play video games for the afternoon instead.
Yes. Yes. Nice. We could stream it.
I was about to say, I like streaming that. That's fine. I've got the setup here. I'm ready for this. Twitch.
Yeah, really, we should be on mobile games, is all I'd say.
Exactly. We could all just be on the rubbish games that Netflix has added to the service. on Android.
You lot can do that. I'll be on GeForce Now on my iPhone, like a cool kid.
Yes, we will be back. I don't know what we'll be talking about. We'll be doing something silly to celebrate our 100th episode and hopefully talking about some actual phones as well. But until then, thank you very much for watching and listening. Remember to like and subscribe if you're on YouTube. And yeah, we'll see you soon. Cheers, everyone.
Bye.
See ya.